Merry Christmas. I'm Pastor Karen Bartkowski. I'm the Associate Pastor here at Lima United Methodist Church, and I'm really glad that you found us today and chose to worship with us. If you're typically watching our online service, you know that it's around 30 minutes in length, and it has a pretty similar flow through each week. This week, we have been given a gift. The Bishop of our Eastern Pennsylvania and Greater New Jersey Conference of the United Methodist Church has recorded a message for us. And along with his cabinet, the district superintendents from all over Eastern Pennsylvania Conference, they've put together a beautiful worship service featuring songs and singing and words of scripture and prayer from folks all over the conference, and including a sermon by our Bishop John Scholl. This service is a bit longer than what you typically are used to coming from Lima, but we hope that you enjoy this gift, that you can sit back, know that you are not worshiping by yourself, but worshiping with folks all over our conference, and as we spread the word all over the country and all over the world. So sit back, enjoy, worship with us as we use this worship service prepared for us by our bishop and the cabinet. Merry Christmas.
We've definitely seen Christmas outfits get more and more interesting throughout the past few years. Even in eastern Pennsylvania, we seem to have embraced the trend. I guess fashion comes in many forms. But in this Christmas season, God is calling us to embrace a new Christmas outfit. In Colossians, we hear the call to clothe ourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Above all, friends, we are called to clothe ourselves with love. We find this love lived out in our actions as we, the body of Jesus, seek to offer our communities the love of God. We see this love as we bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgives each other, just as God has forgiven us. We thank you, Eastern Pennsylvania Annual Conference churches and communities, for being beacons of this love, for putting on the Christmas outfit of Christ, and for living as God's people. Above all, whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him.
Merry Christmas! Welcome to worship. We are glad you are with us as we continue in the Christmas season. We hope that this worship service will deepen your relationship with our God and also our calling to share God's love with the world. In Colossians, we hear the call to clothe ourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Above all, we are called to clothe ourselves with love. We find this love lived out in our actions as we, as the body of Jesus Christ, seek to offer our communities the love of Jesus Christ. We see this love as we bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you. We thank you, Eastern Pennsylvania, and your conference churches and communities for being beacons of this love, for putting on the Christmas outfit of Christ, and for living as God's people. Above all, whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God, the Father, through him. Now please join me in the opening prayer. Let's pray. Shine in our hearts, Lord Jesus. Shine in our lives. Shine in the word now read and proclaimed. And we, children of your light, shining for all people, will follow. Amen.
We are God's beloved people,
called to lives of kindness, humility, and compassion.
God seeks to clothe us with love and to bind us together in harmony.
God desires that we bear with one another and forgive as Christ forgives.
We are God's beloved people,
called to lives of peace and patience, called to live with grateful hearts.
We worship the God
who calls us beloved.
If he so deep,
read from John's letter to the church at Colossus, chapter 3, verses 12 to 17. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. With gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
Merry Christmas. I'm John Scholl, a bishop in the United Methodist Church serving Eastern Pennsylvania. And today I wanted to bring you a special Christmas greeting. Give thanks to God for each and every one of you that continues to help Christmas to happen all year around. God's grace showing up in our congregations and in our communities. You have been an inspiration to me as you continue to carry out the message that Christ is born and alive today. So I hope all of you had a Merry Christmas and God's continued blessing in your life. Today I want to bring you a special message in this Christmas season about compassion. God's love, God's grace through Jesus Christ, and how that same compassion, that same love is lived out through us in the world today. I want to tell you that that kind of love begins with patience. That's right, patience, because patience begets humility, and humility gets gentleness. Gentleness gets kindness, and kindness is acted out in compassionate love. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we give you thanks for this day, and we give you thanks, God, for the birth of Jesus. And we pray, God, in the season of Christmas, that you'll continue to help Jesus come alive in us so that that same love and compassion that you have for us is lived out into the world and others will come and see your love and compassion. So God, perk up our ears. Help us to hear the word you have for us this day. All this we pray in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. It's reported that Albert Einstein once said, "The problem with the speed of light is that it comes too early in the morning." Now think about that. You know, we're in a season of darkness. As a matter of fact, we've just actually shifted. December 21st is actually one of my favorite days of the year because after that, it starts to get lighter. You know, we've reached the darkest point and then it starts to get lighter. Isn't it interesting that we celebrate Christmas in the season of darkness, in the season when it's hard to see, but yet God's light pierces the darkness and brings hope and salvation. Sometimes the problem is that hope and salvation comes too early in the morning, just like the speed of light, and we don't always catch it, even though it's right there. Today, I want to talk with you about putting on love that we heard in this passage from Colossians, about putting on love, putting on compassion. But I especially want to talk with you today about that putting on God's love and living out that love in the world. Well, it takes patience. Anybody who's a parent, anybody who's a supervisor, anybody who drives on the road these days, if you're going to love other people, you got to have patience. You got to be ready to wait. So let's begin to unpack this passage that we heard for us this morning and begin to think about what is God really trying to say to us? You know, this particular verse begins, and the verse that you heard, or the translation that you heard today, begins with the word as this happens. You know, other translations say because or therefore. You know, because, therefore, as, they're all clauses that say, this is about reason. This is about the reason why this happens. This is about our why. Have you ever thought about what is your why? Why do you exist? Why do you get up in the morning? Why do you do what you do? Why are you here today? Have you ever thought about your why? I was watching this program once, and it's a comedian, and he's working the audience, and he asked somebody in the audience to sing the hymn, Amazing Grace. The gentleman stood up and had a deep baritone voice and began to sing Amazing Grace, and he sang it very well. And then the comedian stopped him, and he said, "Now listen, that was great." He said, "But now, I want you to sing it. Well, I want you to sing it as though your daddy died and you lost your job and you're going through a really hard time. Now I want you to sing Amazing Grace." Oh man, did Amazing Grace come alive? It was deep. It was soulful. It was powerful. He had his why. He had his why. You know, if I sang Amazing Grace right now, it would have sounded like that first version. But gosh, you know, when Aretha Franklin sings Amazing Grace, you know she's got a why for singing Amazing Grace. You know it just comes from her inner core and everything that she's experienced and everything that she's gone through. You know, her father was a pastor and had always wanted her to sing in the church. And so she was brought up through that, and the soulful sounds and the challenges that she went through in her life gave her a reason, not just to sing, but a reason to sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. It's grace that's brought me safe this far, and it's grace that will lead me home. Do you have a why? Do you have a why about why you do things the way you do? Do you have a why about why you get up in the morning, even if it's after the speed of light? Do you have a why about where you work, where you go to school, the people you connect with, the service that you do? What's your why? This passage from Colossians begins with our why. And what the writer of Colossians says is, our why, because, this verse starts, because, therefore, God first loved us. God chose us. Wow. Wow. Do we need any more why than that? That we are loved in spite of ourselves. That God first loved us. We didn't have to do anything. God loved us just as we are. God loves us in spite of ourselves sometimes. God loves us. And God chooses us. God wants you. God wants you to be a part of God's movement wherever you are and whatever you're doing. That's our why. God loves us before we even knew what love meant or even how to love. And God has chosen us every time when nobody else would choose us, when nobody else would look to us. God said, "You are mine. I want you." Boy, the writer of Colossians really gets it right. You know, this is the place that we start. We start with our why. God loves us and God chooses us. And then the writer says, now, put on the clothing of, you know, get dressed up in these things. I remember when I was a kid, I had Sunday clothing. You know, it hung in the closet all week long. You didn't wear it any other day. It kind of looked like this, a white shirt, a suit, you know, nice shiny shoes, hair combed. I've worked on my hair quite a bit today. Hair combed, you know, all ready to go to church, Sunday school, and then worship. And we had our Sunday best, we'd call it, Sunday best. We got all dressed up. You know, one of the problems I see and one of the challenges I see is this getting dressed up for church. As a metaphor, it's almost like we have a Sunday life or a weekend life when we worship. And then there's the rest of the week. There's the rest of the week that we do things. I was once working with a lawyer about some important things in the community. And as we were working on these things, we had to go to these sessions and be engaged with other people and had to advocate for certain rights and certain important pieces. And I was trying to bring my Sunday best. I was trying to bring God along with me in these conversations. I was trying to bring the sense that God loves you. And because God loves you, I love you. And the lawyer pulled me aside and said, look, preacher, he said, there's the churchy world, and then there's the lawyer world. And we are in the lawyer world right now. And we have to address things in a certain way. You know, he was sometimes harsh, even used words that doesn't really represent the church. You see, sometimes you can win and lose your very soul. Sometimes you can do all the things that make you victorious, but lose your very self. That happens when we try to bifurcate our lives. God here, the rest of my life here. We try to separate these two pieces. They're not separate. They're all one. God doesn't say, I'm going to love John on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, but not on Tuesdays, Thursdays, Saturdays, and Sundays. No, God loves me every day, every hour, every minute. God doesn't bifurcate. God doesn't love me when I'm doing good and doing things well and right, and then when I'm not, stop loving me. God loves me and chooses me. And so when we put on this clothing that the writer of Colossians says, it's not like we put it on one day or for one activity or for one purpose and take it off the rest of the week. This is the clothing we are to wear all the time, whether in court or out of court, whether in our job or out of our job, when in a tense environment or when everything's calm and peaceful, when somebody's singing Amazing Grace or when somebody's cursing up a storm. This is the clothing that we're called to wear. So what is this clothing that we're called to wear? Oh, I love this. First and foremost, we're called to wear the clothing of compassion. We're called to wear the clothing of love, compassionate love, caring about others, that outward movement of God's Spirit in and through us. We are called to kindness. You know, what good is our love if it's not motivated out of kindness? Have you ever seen love that's motivated by duty? Oh, this is what I'm supposed to do. This is when I'm supposed to do it. And have you ever seen love motivated out of kindness? There's just a sense of this person really cares. They're a kind person. Secondly, or thirdly, you put on the clothing of meekness. That's what the passage said. I like the word gentleness. Gentleness. You know, some of the best people I've ever met in my life are gentle people. I often find they're the salt of the earth people. They're not trying to impose themselves on you. They are just receiving you just as you are, welcoming you just as you are. They have a groundedness to them. They're gentle with you. Their words are not harsh. It doesn't mean that they don't get angry sometimes. It doesn't mean that they don't get frustrated sometimes. It just means that they have this spiritual grounding that runs down through their legs and through their feet and into very creation and rooted with the Creator. Gentle. The clothing of gentleness. And then you put on the clothing of humility. You know, humility essentially says, you matter just like I matter. That's humility. That I'm not better than you and you're not better than me. That we are all children of God. God is in each and every one of us. God cares deeply about each and every one of us. And because God is in us, I can recognize the God that is in you. In yoga, they begin by saying namaste. And it means the divine in me recognizes the divine in you. You know, that's what Jesus was all about. Jesus said the divine is in each one of us. Remember the passage in Matthew 25 when Jesus says, when I was in prison, you came and visited me. When I was sick, you came and nursed me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. And they said, Jesus, when do we ever see you like that? We've never seen you in prison. We've never seen you naked. We've never seen you hungry. And Jesus said, when you've done it to the least of mine, you've done it to me. You see, in other words, when you see me, Jesus, in others, that's when you're really seeing me. Namaste. The divine in me sees the divine in you. Humility. I humble myself because you are as worthy as I am. your thoughts, your objectives, your hopes, your desires are as important as my hopes, my objectives, my desires. That's what humility is all about. And then the writer says, put on the clothing of patience. You know, in the Bible, it's not unusual for the emphasis or the word that's trying to be emphasized here, or what the writer really wants you to see, is the word that comes to the end. Now listen, those are some very powerful words, words that come before it. Love, compassion, gentleness, kindness, humility, they are all powerful words. They are all words that we should emulate. Those are words we should put on every day. But why does the writer put patience at the end? Well, all of those other articles of clothing come through patience. We really can't love unless we're patient. We're patient with each other. We just take time to settle and listen deeply. And we take time just to be gentle with one another. We take time just to humble ourselves. That's what patience is. Now listen, don't misunderstand me. There are times to be impatient. I'm not saying you should always be patient every day of your life. There are times that we should be impatient. We should be impatient with evil. We should be impatient when people do racist things. We should be impatient when people try to destroy creation, abuse creation. We should be impatient when people take advantage of the poor. We should be impatient when there are people who are hungry. We should be impatient when there are people who don't have electricity or heating. There are times to be impatient. But that kind of impatience has already put on all of that other clothing so that our impatience doesn't get in the way of the real objective of helping things to move forward. Our impatience is not about us or not about our demands, but it's what God wants to do in and through us. You know, just when we thought God was losing patience with the world, the world had turned upside down, challenging things, bad things, horrible things, abusive things were happening. People were being enslaved. People were being taken advantage of. People were being persecuted for their beliefs. Just when we thought God had lost patience with the world, God sent Jesus, born in a humble manger with gentle people and gentle animals, all gathered together so that God's compassion could go out into the world. You see, God is patient with us. God loves us first. God cares about us first. God wants to choose us first every time. In my life, that takes a lot of patience because I don't always get it right. I want to get my agenda through. I want to get what I think is important in front of other people. But God keeps being patient with me and loving me just as I am. You know, in the Alani section of Philadelphia, I went to the St. James United Methodist Church and grew up there. I went to the schools in Alani. I went to Alani High School in Philadelphia. And one of the persons that had such a great impression on my life was Dottie Warrington. Dottie Warrington was maybe 5 feet tall, if that. She had this positive energy, bursting with hope and joy. And she was just filled with compassion. She was gentle with us in the fifth and sixth grade of Sunday school. And most of all, she had the patience of a saint. You know, teaching fifth and sixth graders can be a challenge. A lot of energy there. And particularly around the Bible and Sunday school and learning about all those things. But her love just exuded out of her because she would patiently listen to each one of our questions, listen to each one of our stories, take time to just come next to us and sit with us and be with us. Be gentle with us. I have a stronger faith today because of Dottie Warrington. She helped me to learn about my why and why I exist. My why is God first loved me. My why is every day I get up, God chooses me. God keeps trying to help me dress into the clothing that will help me and help the world move forward. Compassion, gentleness, kindness, humility, and patience. In this Christmas season, as we celebrate the birth of Christ, I invite you to put on this clothing so that you might be in the world, that others might see the birth of Christ through you. Amen.
This second day of the Christmas season, December 26th, is a relatively little-known feast day among most of us, the Feast of Stephen, honoring one of the very first Christian martyrs, Acts chapter 7. In European countries, there are all sorts of delightful traditions remembering this hero with a really cool name. In America, admittedly, the day after Christmas is mostly about cleaning up the living room, enjoying leftover meals, and watching football. But I bet you know the song, right? This Christmas carol about good King Wenceslas, a legendary 10th century Bohemian monarch who leaves his palace, despite a bitter winter storm, to present aid to a poor peasant. When? On the Feast of Stephen, December 26th. Detailed within the five stanza narrative of this carol, the king's page, his servant who is to hand off these gifts, he struggles against the cold weather and is about to give up until, at the king's urging, he is able to continue by following the master's footprints step by step through the deep snow. The final verse of the song celebrates the exchange of gifts, food and firewood to the beggar, spiritual joy, contentment for the generous king and his page, and I would say for any years later who follow in that same path. Therefore, Christian friends, be sure, wealth or rank possessing, ye who now will bless the poor, shall yourselves find blessing. I wish you a Merry Christmas, friends, on this second day of the holiday season, on this Feast of Stephen. And I say thank you and praise God for all of your gift-giving, which remembers and aids God's people in the world who are hungry or left out in the cold. Colossians 3 challenges us, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness. Again, here's the promise in this Christmas season. Ye who now will bless the poor, shall yourselves find blessing. Follow in the Master's steps. Bless others and know the gift yourselves.
Lindo, lindo, a ti me rindo, lindo, lindo, eres Good morning to each of you in the Eastern Pennsylvania Conference. We come together during this worship experience to share the love of God and to worship Him. And today I just want to lead you in the pastoral prayer. We come to share with one another, but we also come to lift up others who need God's love and grace. Won't you pray with me today? Oh God, we come before you to express our joy and thanksgiving in this miraculous season. As we celebrate the beauty and mystery of the Christmas event, the birth of the Christ child, we are in awe of the full scope of your love and grace toward humanity. The proclamation of the angel Gabriel to Mary was the beginning of the Christmas story, but the glorious benefits are still blessing us in endless ways from the cradle to the grave. We pray for those who don't know the story. We pray for us who have been called to tell the story and, more importantly, to live it. We pray for the sick in mind, body, or spirit, that you will grant them supernatural healing and wholeness. Help us to minister to them with love and compassion. We pray, O God, for children everywhere, those who are waiting with starry eyes for Christmas morning. Help us to show them the Christ in Christmas and not the commercial entrapments. And, oh God, we pray for children around the globe, the poorest of the poor, who only see poverty, pain, and suffering every day. Use us to be their instruments of transformation in their lives. Let them see the stars of hope and the joy of peace. And because of us, the reality of food, clothing, clean water, safe housing, and a good education. We pray for all people near and far, young and old, in every situation of life. Gift us, O God, with more power than we may be the answer to their prayers, that we may be Christmas people every day of the year. We bless your name. And we give you honor and praise as we pray this prayer in the matchless and holy name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Frosty wind made moan. Earth stood hard as iron, water like a stone. Snow had fallen, snow on snow, snow on snow. Winter long ago. Our God, heaven cannot hold him, nor the earth sustain. Heaven and earth shall flee away when he comes to reign. In the bleak midwinter, a stable place sufficed. The Lord God Almighty, Jesus Christ. Angels and archangels may have gathered there. Cherubim and seraphim throng the air, but his mother only in her maiden bliss worshiped the beloved with a kiss. Then can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. And if I were a wise man, I would do my part. Yet what I can, I give him, give my heart.
As we come to the end of this worship experience, albeit virtually, we know that God is with us. Now receive the benediction. And now unto the one who is still able to keep you from falling and present you before God's throne with great joy, may the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, be with you now and forever, for the best is yet to come. Amen. Thank you.